Let's do a little housekeeping thing here. If you will, please get your cell phone and put it on silence so we get started here, please. On behalf of the family, we want to welcome here and thank you for coming to honor our brother, Bud Wilson. Today is a bittersweet day for us. As friends and family, we don't have Bud with us. But it's a sweet day also because we celebrate his going home. As Ron Rose normally say, he has punched our ticket. He is now on the other side. And we all, one day, are looking forward to that day where we will be with our Savior. And so we rejoice knowing that Bud is in a better place, and we all look forward to that day when we will see him again. Before I pray, I want to read 1 Thessalonians 4:13 and 14. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. And this is what we believe. But it's temporarily gone from us, but we'll see him again, and we'll see him in a better place, in better health than he has been lately. So to the family, best, Chuck, Lyle, I know Jeff is not here, and the grandkids, hold on to the memories, the great memories that Bud and Bess built over 70 years, a foundation for all of you. So lean on that, and God is going to be your guide. Let's pray. Holy Father, we thank you. We thank you for a life well lived, for Bud, for the life he lived as a servant, serving in your kingdom, always willing to do what is needed to serve others and live a humble life, Lord, as you ask us to. So we pray, Lord, that you'll be with Bess as she grieves the loss of her husband, her partner for life. And be with the children, too, Father, for losing their father, and the grandkids for their grandfather. Father, be with them that they can lean on those great memories they have built over 7 decades, that they can be strong and that they can feel your presence in every day as they struggle on those days that they feel a dark spot. Father, lift their spirit. Let them feel your presence. And remember how Bud supported them, the things that they did together that they enjoy, and Father, that they can celebrate those times. Father, be with us as a family of believers. Father, that we can continue to support Bess with all what she needs, Lord. And just, Father, keep her strong. We know she's a strong woman and a great servant. She loves all, just like you have commanded us to love others. She's always willing to do for others. So we just ask, Lord, that you keep her strong. Keep the family close to you. Keep the family united, strong, and have that legacy of Bud going forward, Lord, serving, doing things that will honor and glorify your name. Father, we thank you for Jesus, who made this all possible by giving his life on the cross, that we can come to you in times of grief and time of celebration. And Father, we pray all this in his holy name. Amen.
This morning we're going to sing some wonderful old songs. This is one of the first ones, I'll Fly Away. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To a land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. To Canaan's land I'm on my way, where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear-dimmed eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. I'm on my way to that fair land where the soul never dies, where there will be no parting hand and the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dimmed eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies.
Emmett Jean Bud Wilson was born September 30, 1928, passed into the arms of our Lord Jesus Christ on March the 28th, just a few days ago in Fort Worth, Texas. He and his wife of 72 years, Bessie, lived nearby here in Arlington for most of their adult lives. After serving our country in the Air Force, Bud graduated from West Virginia University in 1954 with a Bachelor of Aeronautical Engineering degree and took employment with Chance Vought, which is now Lockheed Martin, where he worked for 36 years. He was a longtime member and a former deacon of benevolence here at the Woodland West Church of Christ, and he worked tirelessly at Hearts and Hands to serve those in need. A life member of the National Rifle Association and the Arlington Sports Club, of which he was a founding member, Bud was chosen Sportsman of the Year at the Arlington Sports Club in 1996, having served as the club as a board member for many of those years. He was also an avid collector of handmade folding knives, as you would know if you've ever been to his home. Many of these knives made by Texas artisans, and that instilled a keen interest and one of his granddaughters who took up that love and passion as well. With a quick smile, an infectious laugh, Bud brought much joy into many lives, and he will undoubtedly be greatly missed. He's survived by his wife, Bessie, sons, Chuck, and wife, Deborah, Lyle, and wife, Janice, and Jeff, their granddaughters, Corey, Casey, and Olivia, grandsons, Tristan, Travis, and Ian, great-granddaughter, Ella, and great-grandson, Sawyer. As was said earlier, we believe that Bud will rise again at the resurrection, at the last day, because we believe in the one who said long ago, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And you're sitting in a room full of people who believe this. We live by faith, not by sight. And we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. The basis of this, Bud lived out his days no longer living for ourselves, but for the one who died for us and was raised again. We're going to sing a few more songs in a couple of minutes, but before we do that, I'm going to share some stories from the family. And there's a lot of stories, obviously, that we can always tell, and I encourage the family to continue to tell the stories, and all of you to share the stories with the family and with one another of the ways that Bud was special to you, the memories that you have, the way he was an example to you, the way he encouraged you, inspired you. But I always remind everybody at the end of a memorial, it would be easy for us to walk away and say, that's it. Is that it? That's all there is? No, there's so much more. We cannot possibly tell the story of somebody who's lived well and lived as long as Bud lived and tell all the stories. I remind you that the gospel writers were wrestling with the same thing at the end of John's gospel. He's like, there's a whole lot more you could say about Jesus, right? But what I've written because I want you to believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Bud lived his life believing he is the Son of God. And as we leave the space today, know there's so many more stories that can and need to be told. And I encourage you to tell those stories. Now, Bud's story began before he met Bess. Just underline that for you. But my sense is that Bud's story began anew and had a bigger meaning to him when Bess became not just a primary leading role in his story, but the leading role in his story. According to the family, it all began when Bess graduated from high school. For those that might be interested to know, Bess was early in school. The school where she lived, they needed one more kid to keep the teacher. And so, okay, let's get this four-year-old over here, get her in. She was going to be a filler, but she actually just went ahead and did it and graduated very young at 16 years old, right, from high school. So anyway, she lived her life. At the beginning, was in the metropolis of Bean Ridge, West Virginia, a town of 200 souls. And Bud lived in the big city of Harrisville, which was the county seat of Ritchie County, and had a population of well over 1,000 souls. So that's kind of where their roots are. That's where their story begins. Bud was home from his time in the Air Force. Bess had moved into the big town. She was working at the drugstore and was living in a boarding house. It was across the side street from the house where Bud and his parents lived. And just so happened that as that happened, many of you remember back in the day that a lot of American culture was time was passed sitting on the front porch. Some of your front porches might have had a swing. And once Bud had noticed this young lady walking to and from work, he began to time his scheduled time on the front porch to coincide with when this young lady was walking to and from work. And so, now what's interesting is that as fate would have it, before you know it, they were on a double date together. And Bess describes this for her as a blind date. Only they weren't on the date with the other, right? And so after that date was over, evidently conversations were had. It's like, you're the one I'd rather be with, right? And so that begins to happen. And those things move forward in the story. And the way I was told by the family that best describes it this way, that she chased Bud, she chased Bud, she chased Bud until Bud turned around and caught her. I mean, so that's how that worked out. When it came time for them to find a preacher to marry them, it's an interesting story here. Bess's grandparents actually grew up Baptist, but they ended up giving some land in the small town there for a cemetery and a Methodist church. So they became Methodist. And for reasons we won't get into, Bess didn't want to be married by the circuit preacher of the Methodist church there. So and evidently Bud's preacher wouldn't do it because, you know, Methodist, Church of Christ, and all that kind of stuff. So I think it was, let me make sure I say it right. Yeah, it was Bud's sister, Vesta, who was a bank teller there in the town. She knew of a Evangelical United Brethren minister who he'll do it, Price is Right. So they got him to do it, and they got married in the front parlor room of the farmhouse where Bess grew up. Now, here's the interesting part of the story to me, is that Bess made it very clear to me that she did not want Bud's mother at the funeral. And I'm thinking, wow, what's the backstory there? So, but as she went on to explain the story, it wasn't that there was anything going on between her and her future mother-in-law, but she just knew that if her mother-in-law was there, she was going to ruin the wedding. She was going to be sitting over there blubbering and bawling and crying and wailing and all that, right? This is going to ruin it. And so, but you can say, she was there. Her mother-in-law was there. And sure enough, as the wedding gets started, somewhere in the middle of the wedding, you start hearing some sniffling, and it starts in. Only it wasn't Bud's mother, it was Bess's dad, right, that was just losing control emotionally of what's happening here as this little girl is about to marry this man, or is getting married to this man. But anyway, after they got married, they headed up to Morgantown, West Virginia. That's where the University of West Virginia, Mountaineers. And so I'm wearing this tie for those colors for him today. He went there, got his degree. The plan was, and the agreement was, you help me get through school. And then when I'm done, it'll be your turn and you'll go through school. And that happened eventually. But there was a pause in that agreement as family started arriving. And there were boys that came into the story. And so Bess spent that season of her life devoted to raising these boys and loving on them and helping them to grow into the young man that they became. And then as that was ending, as Jeff was getting into high school, and as my understanding, his senior year, and some of you in this room knew them at that time, that's when she went on to school and got several degrees, got a nursing degree, went on, got a master's degree as well. And the story was told to me that at her graduation with her master's degree, Bud showed up with two gifts in his hand, two gifts, and was going to let her choose which one she wanted, just pick one or the other. And then as the conversation unfolded, it finally was, listen, if you want both gifts, I'll give you both gifts if you promise you're not going to go on for another degree. This is it. And so that's what she chose to do. And I don't know what those gifts were, but anyway. So, but Bud loved his wife. Bud loved you best, and you know that, and the boys know that, and I think that's a great example that he's blessed you guys to see what it is for two people to be fully devoted and committed to one another in the way that you were. And I know that you've been blessed to have 72 years together. That's amazing, and we're just excited for the beautiful example that you've given to us and that, and to your family, that legacy and that story. Now, one of the things going back to the early years that I will share with you, and this won't make a lot of sense to some of the younger ones in the room, but as you can imagine, two young people going away to college back in the early 1950s, and he's fresh out of the Air Force, she's fresh off the farm town, and things would be tight, right, financially, and plus now you've got another one on the way. So one of the things that they shared that was a part of getting through that was a silver dollar. Now, a dollar doesn't buy a whole lot now, but back in the 50s, right, you could get some stuff for a dollar. And so Bess evidently had a silver dollar that at the end of the month, when they ran out of stuff, there's still more month, she used that silver dollar to get whatever supplies they needed at the store to get them through. And the merchant at that store was kind enough to hold on to that silver dollar so that once the GI Bill monthly stipend came in, okay, we'll give you your silver dollar back when you're making this purchase. And so that silver dollar got them through, and I know that it meant a lot to her and all that time. So one story that Bess wanted me to share with you today was about a big summer family trip that they took together. Part of their story involved spending some time in California, and I'm sure there's a ton of stories there that they could share with you, including an earthquake or two that they survived. But they planned this big summer trip that was going to involve getting in a car together with all the boys, driving across the country to Texas, then going up to Michigan, and then over to West Virginia. And that's where all their family and friends were. And so they got on the road, started making their way, and they were in a brand new Chevy Impala. One night they were all sleeping in their little Apache tent trailer camper. But it was so small, it was big enough, but it was so small that there wasn't room for the ice chest. And so they set the ice chest just outside the door. And the boys were telling me that they heard that ice chest somehow just lift up and whisk away. And they heard the footsteps. And so as two young teenage boys, they're like, man, we're not standing for this. So they're throwing stuff on as fast as they can, grabbing their flashlight, and they're out the door chasing this ice chest down. They find the ice chest, the conversation ensues, there's denials, there's accusations, words are said, and evidently there were a few words that were said by some of the Wilson boys that were not on the approved Bud and Bess Wilson list of words we're allowed to say in this family. And so out of the darkness, while the skirmish is starting to happen and things are happening, comes this booming voice that says, "Gentlemen, watch your language." And it's like, okay, so all this tension's happening and there's safety involved, and Bud is, hey, you know what? This isn't how we roll in the Wilson family. Gentlemen, watch your language. So, skirmish. It got dicey, testy. Evidently, there was a tire iron that was involved in that. Bus explained that even as this tire iron was lifted up, headed towards evidently a collision with Bud's head, Bess just summoned all that she had and said, "Don't you dare." And it went down and nothing happened. And Bud finally had the conversation with the gentleman involved. There was about 8 to 10 of them. It's like, listen, guys, it's like, why did you resort to stealing? We would have shared with you if you just asked for help. That's who Bud is, and that's his life, right? That's his legacy of helping people in need, and even in that moment. Now, if I remember the story correctly, I don't think they stayed the night at that spot. They were like, you know what, let's just go ahead and get on the road. But as we move forward in this same road trip, it's my understanding that it was Chuck, he's the oldest son, it was his turn to drive. They're driving down the road in this brand new Chevy Impala when every light on the dash lights up. And I'm sure everybody in the car either said or thought, Chuck, what did you do? All right. So the car pulls over, they open the hood, and every belt on that thing's laying on top of the engine. Something had broken. They had to get a part from Phoenix. I think that took a couple of days. They had to get a part from Denver. I mean, it had to come from all over. They were stuck for about 4 days on that road trip. So plans were adjusted, obviously. But that's a memory that they'll always have of that trip and how hard it was, but that's part of life. And I know the boys just sharing with me how faith being such a vital part of their lives, and how Bud and Bess leaned on each other's faith at time, encouraged each other when they went through the hard things, and especially when either one of them would grow weary and tired of the challenge and the struggle, but they were there for each other. And they never let go of their faith and their hope. And so with that thought in mind, there's one more story that I wanted to share. And I'll share that in a moment. I'm going to come back and tie that into their faith in just a second. But we're going to go ahead and pause here. We're going to sing a couple more. And all these songs that we're singing, these were songs that Bud wanted us to sing. And so we're going to sing Home of the Soul, and then I'm Bound for the Promised Land, and then we'll come back to this theme of journey and traveling and all those things. So.
If for the prize we have striven, after our labors are o'er, rest to our souls will be given on the eternal shore. Home of the soul, beautiful home, there we shall rest, never to roam. Free from all care, happy and bright, Jesus is there. He is the light, oft in the storm. Lonely are we, sighing for home, longing for thee. Beautiful home of the ransom beside the crystal sea. Soon the bright homeland adorning, we shall behold the glad dawn. Lean on the Lord till the morning, trust till the night is gone. Home of the soul, beautiful home, there we shall rest, never to roam. Free from all care, happy and bright, Jesus is there. He is the light, oft in the storm. Lonely are we, sighing for home, longing for thee. Beautiful home of the ransom beside the crystal sea. When the trumpet shall sound and the dead shall arise and the splendors immortal shall envelop the skies, when the angel of death shall no longer destroy and the dead shall awaken in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, we'll be gathered to glory in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, we'll be gathered to glory in the morning of joy. Oh, the bliss of that morn when our loved ones we meet, with the songs of the ransom we each other shall greet, singing praise to the Lamb through eternity's years, with the past all forgiven, sorrows and tears. In the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, we'll be gathered to glory in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy, we'll be gathered to glory in the morning of joy.
Isaiah 41, verse 10. This was Bud's favorite passage of Scripture. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Faith in Jesus was an incredibly important part of Bud Wilson's life. He'd grown up in church. His dad filled in as a preacher as needed at the local congregation where he grew up. And he learned to love Jesus. He learned to follow Jesus. As I said earlier, Bud and Bess trusted and the goodness and faithfulness of the Lord. And they leaned on each other. They helped each other. They encouraged each other. And they raised their boys to know Jesus and constantly repeating this refrain, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God." So wherever they went, wherever they lived, being a part of a church family was always a high priority for them. And not just to be there, not just to belong, but to roll up their sleeves and to serve and to make relationships and to encourage their fellow brothers and sisters in Christ to walk serving the Lord with all their heart. Bud and Bess have been a blessing to this church for a really long time. I don't know, one of the things that they love serving at Hearts and Hands, they also love coming together every Wednesday to just spend some time in fellowship meal and an afternoon and playing games or putting together puzzles, but just being with their brothers and sisters in Christ, sharing their lives together and encouraging one another again in whatever ways they needed to. So they loved their boys and their grandchildren that God gave to them and their family, but they loved their church family, their brothers and sisters, God's family that he gave to them. And I want to share a story with you that they asked me to include. They went camping in the Angeles National Forest. And of course, I was like, Angeles, but think Los Angeles. And it's right there just outside of the big city, but there's a big national forest and park right there close to the city. And so they went on a trip, as they were prone to do with their boys. And as always, look, we're on vacation, but we're going to go to church. So they came down off the mountain, and it's a different time and era. Just remind us, you know, we're so accustomed now, whip out your phone and look for a navigation to tell you where something is, or go online and look for, that's a different time and era. Where are you going to find a church? You're in town, you don't know very well. So they rolled down off the mountain early in the morning, Sunday morning, the Lord's Day, to look for, find Church of Christ where they could be for that morning. And I got there too early, so they sat in the car and waited for everybody to start arriving. And they did, and they went inside, and they said it was just a great experience. I spent some time in Bible study and the Word of God, and then the worship time, and everybody was super friendly with them, interacting with them. And as they were leaving, someone called out from behind them, evidently noticed the Texas license plate, and said, "Hey, Tex, wait up." And so they turned around, had a conversation. As this conversation is playing itself out, at some point, a light bulb went off in Bud's head, and he said to everybody in the group, "We have a problem. There's three sets of keys locked in that car over there." So the gentleman that he's talking to says, "No problem, Bess and the boys. You just go home with my wife. We're going to take care of you guys, get some dinner taken care of." Just so happened this gentleman was the manager of a Chevrolet dealership there in town. He's like, "I got this. We'll get this figured out." And so they got that sorted out, went off and had a good lunch and a good afternoon with them. But then as it turned out, what they discovered is they're having dinner with the niece of an elder at a church over here in Grand Prairie, where Bud and Bess had been members for several years before they headed out to California. And one of the things that that impressed upon them again is just how God is with you. God's always with you, and God's family is everywhere now in this wonderful world we live in. And God takes care of us, and oftentimes he takes care of us through his people, their kindness and their hospitality and the love of Jesus that lives within them. And I know that in the same way that they were blessed in this moment, that time and time again that Bud and Bess were blessing to others in the same way. But our God is awesome. Our God is always watching over us, and he watched over and blessed Bud and Bess and their family on through the years. We're going to sing another final song in just a second. But before we do that, I want to read to you from the Word of God in Revelation 21, verses 22 through 27. As we think of the great day, the coming day, that Christ will come again, and he'll bring Bud and everybody else that we're longing to see again. He will bring with him all of those who've fallen asleep in the Lord. And it's going to be a great and an awesome experience, not only to see the risen Lord, but to see everyone else raised to live life eternal. But we don't know everything about what that's going to be, exactly how that will be. But in John's vision that God gave to him long ago on the island of Patmos, he gave him a glimpse of some things that give us a great deal of hope for our future. I want to read to you the very end of that vision, verse 22 of chapter 21. John says, "I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations, all the nations of the world, the nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." As I think of Bud and the honors that he's known in his life, as we said earlier, he was a founding member of the Arlington Sportsman's Club, 96, chosen as the Sportsman of the Year. And so I'm confident, I haven't seen it, but I'm confident somewhere in that building, I bet Bud's name's written on the wall, hanging up proudly. Just a few days, his body will be taken to the Dallas-Fort Worth National Cemetery. His name will be carved in stone somewhere in that cemetery. And these are honors. But the greater honor is to know that his name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Long ago, our Lord said to a group of men who came back to him, and they were ecstatic, they were pumped up, they were on fire, that the Spirit of God that Jesus had given to them had enabled them to do unbelievable and incredible things. They were healing the sick. They were driving out demon spirits in the spiritual realm. Unclean spirits submitted to them when they spoke words. And Jesus said this to them, "I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." There are things we get excited about in this life. And I always loved talking to Bud and Bess. He was more excited about when his Mountaineers were doing well in football or basketball or something like that. But something that I know especially excited him and ought to excite us is to know that your name is written in heaven and that we hold on to that perspective that can't be taken away from us. And so this day, as we remember Bud, I want to say it one more time, these powerful words. Nothing impure will ever enter it. No one who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. In closing, I want to share with you the Word of God in 1 John 5, verses 11 through 13. This is the testimony that God has given to us. God has given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has the life. And whoever does not have the Son of God does not have the life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. Let's sing this last song.
On Jordan's stormy banks wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land where my possessions lie. I am bound for the promised land, I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land. When he shall reach that happy place and be forever blessed, when shall I see my Savior's face and in his bosom rest? I am bound for the promised land, I'm bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land.
Tuesday morning, as Bud breathed his last breath, something remarkable happened. As Bud's life came to an end, there was a beginning. And the beginning was far greater than the end. Because the beginning will last for an eternity. Something remarkable that we truly can't even understand today, but that we believe with all of our heart. I've been asked to share a couple of closing passages with you. First, from Hebrews. And I'll paraphrase it slightly. The passage says, remember your leaders. But for us here today, I think we could say, remember your husband, your father, your grandfather and great-grandfather, your friend, who spoke and shared the word of God with you. Not simply by words, but by the way he lived. Consider the outcome of his way of life and imitate his faith. And from 2 Timothy, words that Paul wrote to reflect the coming end of his own life are so appropriate for Bud. Bud Wilson has finished the race. He has kept the faith. Now there is in store for him the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to him on that day. And not only to him, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for blessing us with Bud Wilson for 94 years, for all of the ways that he has touched the lives of the people in this room and countless lives outside of this room, for the way that he lived his life, for the example that he was, for his faith and hope in a tomorrow that he's now embraced. God, it has been such a blessing, and we are thankful that you gave us this time with him. And we are also thankful that a new time has begun for him, that eternity has dawned for him, an eternity that will never end, one that we long for as well. Father, in the midst of our sorrow, may we be comforted by the knowledge that Bud has won the victory he lived his entire life to win, and that he has come home. For the last time, he has come home. And that he will never leave again. That we will go in our time to join him. And we look forward to when we will be reunited with all of those who have gone before us in Jesus. And we look forward to the day when Jesus will come and take all of us who are remaining to be home. And we echo the words of our brother John so long ago, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." But until then, may we be faithful as Bud was. In the powerful name of Jesus, the risen and returning Savior, we pray all of these things. Amen.
This concludes the memorial service. The family will be staying for lunch in just a bit, but everybody's welcome to come up and spend some time talking with them before they dismiss to that. The lane assignment for the burial at the Dallas-Fort Worth National Cemetery is not yet known, but if you will just be checking the email, if you remember in the West, we'll get that information to you as soon as we know it. Or you can contact the Moore Funeral Home. They'll have that information as well later next week. But God bless each and every one of you. And again, we just say to the family, our hearts are with you. Our prayers are with you. May God shine his face on you and bless you every day, today and always. We're dismissed.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home. In my home yesterday.